Welcome to the Federalist Society panel on the FCC and the First Amendment. Thank you to the Federalist Society for another spectacular national convention, for just a series of wonderful panels, and for hosting this panel in particular, and thank you all for being here. We've gathered an extraordinary group, and what I'll do is briefly introduce each panelist in the order they're going to be speaking, and then mention a few of the topics of interest, and then each of them will speak. We'll give them some time to respond to each other, and then questions from the audience. Miguel Estrada will speak first. He's a partner in the Washington office of Gibson, Dunn & Crutcher, is co-chair of the firm's appellate and constitutional law practice group. He's been an assistant to the Solicitor General, a federal prosecutor, has argued 21 cases before the Supreme Court, and most relevant for present purposes, has argued some of the most important First Amendment and communication law cases in the courts of appeals in the last several years. One of the finest lawyers in the United States, and we're honored to have him here with us today. Jane Mago is Executive Vice President and General Counsel of the National Association of Broadcasters, responsible for all aspects of coordinating the legal strategy, which is a wide berth. She joined the association several years ago after more than 25 years at the FCC, where she held many high-level positions, including general counsel and legal advisor to three commissioners. We really appreciate Ms. Mago for being with us today. Professor Marvin Amori is both a scholar and a practicing lawyer and a gentleman in the field of internet policy and freedom of expression. He represents companies including Google, Dropbox, and WordPress on a range of matters, has academic homes at the New America Foundation and at Stanford Law School Center for the Internet and Society. Welcome, Mr. Amori, Professor Amori. Glad you're here as well. And then our final speaker will be Ajit Pai, who's commissioner of the Federal Communications Commission, took office in 2012 for a term that ends in 2016. He's done all sorts of important and interesting work before coming to the FCC as a commissioner. He's been previously in their office of general counsel, worked at Jenner and Block, worked at Verizon, worked on the Hill as chief counsel of one of the Senate Judiciary Committee subcommittees. So thank you very much, Commissioner Pai, for being here and for your public service as well. Our topic today is the FCC and the First Amendment. And the FCC really labors under a burden that other regulatory agencies do not, because it regulates entities that transmit, edit, and produce speech. So the FCC regularly confronts some of the most difficult and interesting issues in First Amendment law. What is the nature of an editor entitled to First Amendment protection? Is a cable company really like a bookstore or newspaper when it selects which networks to carry? Can broadband service providers that connect us to the internet favor particular sources of content? When or how can the FCC seek to alter what it sees as inequality in the marketplace for speech? How can it seek to ensure that consumers have access to a diversity of content? And can the FCC really just trust the market to solve those problems? How can the FCC protect children from offensive content consistent with the First Amendment? How, generally, to deal with a very rapidly changing marketplace and to do so in a way that stays consistent with First Amendment values? Our panel will discuss these and many other interesting issues. Mr. Estrada, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Judge Kavanaugh. It's always a pleasure to be in such a distinguished company. Please vote for me in my next case. Now, the title of this panel is the FCC. I don't have a next case yet pending, so it's safe. The panel, you know, the title here is, you know, the FCC versus the First Amendment. I think that's not entirely fair, though I don't think it's entirely fair either to say that the FCC is laboring very hard to comply with the First Amendment. I think, you know, the short of the problem is that the FCC enjoys the benefit of certain rules of law that were developed quite likely for good reason, in an age in which technology was quite different. And where the justifications for the rule of law, to the extent that they were made to jive with the First Amendment, like Cinderella's shoes jived in the shoes of the stepsisters, were quite different. I mean, and so you have the examples, two of which were mentioned today, and I think are worth highlighting. One of them is the indecency regulation of broadcast, which was validated by the Supreme Court some 40 years ago on the theory that broadcast television is uniquely accessible to children and uniquely pervasive. Now, that was the justification for indecency on broadcast. We have since had the same problems come up in the context of telephony and cable, and it's very clear from the Supreme Court case law that the same restrictions do not apply to all of these other technologies. So we live in a world now in which most of the households in the country get broadcast signals through cable, in which you can have next to each other channels in which it is perfectly lawful to say F and S, but if you flip one over on the dial, that's subject to FCC regulation. And the FCC continues to say that even though the technology has changed massively over the decades, that that continues to be appropriate, thanks to an ever-shifting series of rationales. It is worth noting that when you give government, you know, the power of invading speech restrictions or any other liberties, you know, the government never lets go of the ability to invade the liberty. It only comes up with new bases on which to continue doing the invading. Now, the second aspect of this, you know, second example is the whole area of regulating cable. The cable industry was subjected to significant regulation in 1992. The theory for the regulation was empirically a very good one, right? In the world in which we lived in 1992, coming out of the 1980s, you had monopoly power, what the court called bottleneck power. You had to go to the cable company. There was no other option. They were able to leverage into related markets of programming. If they owned a programmer, they were able to deny that to any fledgling would-be competitor. And so when these issues got to the Supreme Court in the Muskerry case, the court concluded that the cable companies in these contexts, like Muskerry, had to be subject to intermediate scrutiny, the whole basis of which is that the basis for the regulation is unrelated to speech or to the suppression of ideas. In 1980 and 1992, the government could plausibly say that the basis for the regulation was purely economic. It was an anodyne control of monopoly power, and therefore that any restriction on speech was somewhat incidental. Now, fast forward to 2013, you have incredible competition in the video programming market and among MVPDs. You have a situation in which cable used to be the only game in town, and now, although the largest MVPD in the country is a cable company, number two and three are satellite companies, Dish and DirecTV, not in that order, and the telephony companies are seven and eight. I mean, you know, the market has changed massively. You can curate your own video choices by going to the internet. You can watch things that were originally intended for broadcast on the internet, on DVDs, or in any other number of areas. And the question then is whether when the commission continues to insist on the same rules that were developed for a competitive rationale, in a world in which the competitive rationale begins to wane more and more, does it make sense for the courts to reassess the rule of law in light of what the market is today, to say that as understood today, the rule cannot be justified by reference to the non-speech requirement? There was a case in the DC Circuit that came down earlier this year. Judge Kavanaugh was on the panel. You know, the issue was basically whether you could force a cable company to carry, you know, the tennis channel on terms other than the cable company was prepared to carry them. And the question was whether this was not, after all, not a competitive regulation, because the tennis channel was carried by Comcast and could be carried by its own parents, which happened to be satellite companies, but whether this was just pure and simple a preference on the part of the commission for one kind of speech over another. You may be interested to learn that the theory of the commission in this case was that Comcast owned the Golf Channel, and golf is sort of like tennis, you know, they both appeal to old white people. And so they were comparable at some rough content level, and therefore it was a telltale sign of intentional discrimination that had quote-unquote market consequences. Now the DC Circuit ended up making short work of that claim, but it is to me emblematic of the proposition that once you give an agency like the FCC the authority to invade these sorts of liberties for a very narrow structure rationale like the protection of competition, the competitive rationale could cease to apply in the view of any rational human being, and yet an agency like every other government agency will continue to look for occasions for the applications of all powers to new situations that have nothing to do with the rationale that generated them. And that is, in some substance, you know, the type of the conversation that I wanted to start with the panel. I am sure that my co-panelists will have some words of indignant disagreement with me, and I'm looking forward to them.
Ms. Mago?
All right, I will start up here. I will have some words of indignant disagreement, but I'll save those for just a little bit. First of all, let me agree that I am honored to be on this very esteemed panel. I truly appreciate the opportunity to get a chance to speak with you all today. Judge Kavanaugh noted that I spent a fair amount of time at the FCC and mentioned some of the jobs that I had, but one of the key jobs that I had when I was there was that I was in the appellate litigation division for probably the majority of the time that I spent at the agency, and I spent a fair amount of time defending the FCC before the DC Circuit and other courts on many issues, including one of the worst beatings I ever took was over indecency regulation when I tried to defend the 24-hour ban on indecency regulation way back in the, somewhere in the 1980s, I think it was.
89.
someplace in there. But, I was interested, Miguel already alluded to it, the name of this panel, and I thank you, Judge Kavanaugh, for changing it as you talked about it, to the FCC and the First Amendment, as opposed to the FCC versus the First Amendment, because in those days it was always one of those feelings that you had that, look, it wasn't intended to be against the First Amendment, but there are certain regulations that, as a federal agency, you have to try to follow. That said, I agree with a lot of what Miguel said, that sometimes you can kind of get off on a track and go down the road a little bit too far. And there's some areas where my current members, the broadcasters, frequently see that there are some issues that they have with where the FCC has gone on the First Amendment. We've already mentioned the area of indecency. Let me step back for one second. An awful lot of the reason for that, that sort of different treatment that broadcasters get, is based in some case law, as Miguel indicated, that seems to say that broadcasters have lesser First Amendment rights than other groups. And we think that increasingly in this world, that that's something that is entirely unjustified. The notion that you would say that you can look at one channel on a cable system and have one set of rules that apply to it as opposed to the next channel seems to us to be something that really ought to be addressed. But it's really not just with regard to that aspect of it. There's any number of things where, whether it's dealing with broadcast ownership rules, which seem to be very much applied to the broadcast arena, and yet they've been struck down with regard to cable, in large part because there was some recognition of federal First Amendment rights being indicated. We always think that that there ought to be a relook at all of that to see where we should be going. Now, all that said, broadcasters do accept that we do have to provide service to our communities. We do accept that there's some content regulation that that we've simply accepted over the years, though there may be some question about it. Children's regulation, I think, was mentioned as one of those possibilities. More recently, we've had some rules put in place with regard to the political files that we all keep about campaigns. And the major concern that we have there is really that the rules that say that broadcasters have to put their political files online apply only to broadcasters, whereas the political files that for cable operators and others do not have to be online. That creates a competitive disadvantage that we think is very concerning and hope to be able to continue to try to address. Let's see, there's other things that are on our radar screen in terms of First Amendment issues that keep coming up every now and again. We worry about reporter shields. NAB regularly files with regard to various actions trying to force reporters to reveal their sources. We think that that's a very important area. It's not really the FCC, but actually there's an angle that's coming in here that I want to put on everybody's radar screen with regard to the commission's looking at critical information needs. We raised this in our comments before the agency where we explained that if the agency starts looking at the editorial judgments that are being made in newsrooms and starts trying to form regulations based on that, that very much is something that tries to invade the First Amendment rights, the editorial discretion of the broadcasters, the freedom of the press, that we think is a very important part of the First Amendment and ought to be looked at. Let me take just a minute and turn to the end part of Miguel's comments here this morning today. The Turner case. I think that an awful lot of times when people are looking at that case, they do try to focus on just the bottleneck aspect of it. But that wasn't the only justification that the government had when they were imposing the rules in the Cable Act. In addition to that, they were in fact trying to preserve the benefits of free over-the-air television. And recognize that there is a value to communities in having free over-the-air television, and having disparate rules was something that was going to be a continuing problem. They were also trying to promote the widespread availability of differing points of view, and that's one of the other aspects of that case and of those regulations that I think is something that is worthy of being a part of the debate as we talk about the changed circumstances and where we go. So I just raised that as an issue that we ought to talk about. We were asked to try to keep our comments to a relatively short time. I have no idea how long I just took, but I hope it was under 10 minutes. Seven, good. That's where I was trying to hit. So I'll just stop there and we'll open it up for further conversation as we go along. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, and we'll turn to Professor Amori now.
Great, thank you. So talking about the First Amendment means talking about the Constitution, and not every dumb law is unconstitutional. Congress can pass a whole bunch of dumb laws, as can the FCC.
And hey.
It's happened before Ajit
it's
showed up.
It's a contest.
I'll agree with the Miguel on that. So we're already finding points of agreement. So when you're talking about the First Amendment and the FCC, a lot of dumb laws that the FCC tries to pass or tries to adopt get struck down for administrative law reasons, or you know, there are a lot of times where you have a concurrence at the end saying, you know, I wish we'd gotten to the First Amendment point and struck down the FCC's really dumb idea. When that happens, you'd also constrain Congress, right? Because Congress is also constrained by the Constitution. And so whenever the FCC is arguing a sort of First Amendment point against industry, you know, one of my thoughts is what would I think if Congress had passed this law? Do we want to ensure that Congress would still have this authority even if the FCC does not? And my sort of take on how we should think about the First Amendment when it comes to cable companies and phone companies especially, is I think there is a history of treating them as conduits of speech, not always just speakers or editors of speech. There's a history, both for phone companies and cable companies. And when they're treated as conduits, Congress will often impose rules on them to carry the speech of other folks. So think of the phone system. It's subject to something called common carrier regulation. Any of you can pick up the phone system and make a call. And by law, the phone system, the phone companies don't, quote, edit your speech, aren't treated as newspapers, aren't seen as editors. And most of the time, people think that's not a big free expression problem, even though phone companies are in the speech business and are carrying speech. Move over to the cable side. The cable companies carry channels. They have some editorial discretion to choose the channels they carry, but they're often treated also as conduits. Right? There's the must-carry rules that require carriage of broadcasters. Right? So I mean, imagine newspapers were required to carry the speech of broadcasters in their pages. That would probably not fly, but in the cable side, under the Turner case, broadcasters have the right to be carried by cable companies. Same in theory with public educational governmental channels, same in theory with independent programmers, right? These companies have been treated very often as conduits who can be regulated by Congress without violating the First Amendment. And so when we talk about whether or not a doctrine like Turner should be reviewed, the question becomes, should we give more, should we protect cable companies more constitutionally when they want to say, no, we want to edit and control every channel on our system, don't want to be subject to any FCC rules determining which channels might end up there. We want to be just like a newspaper editor. That's sort of the question. And once you step into First Amendment doctrine to try to peel this back, you're stepping in, as most of you know, a complicated morass, right? You have three standards of scrutiny, depending on the type of law. You have different standards, perhaps, for broadcasting, cable, perhaps for phone, perhaps, just all across the board. Even when it comes to broadcasting, we've discussed indecency, and we haven't quite discussed laws that ensure that politicians have, equal access when it comes to buying commercial time on broadcast. But both those are subject to different rationales. One is under the Red Line rationale, one is under Pacifica, right? Indecency cases are treated different from access cases, right? On the cable side, Playboy gets strict scrutiny for indecency. Turner got intermediate scrutiny for something else. So it's kind of a morass out there, and you take all this doctrine that applies differently to different mediums, and then you come upon the internet, right? And the internet provides data, video, text, audio, all these different kinds of content, and it's provided over wireless connections, right? My phone, your tablet, the internet comes over wired connections. And so if you're trying to sort of transport or get some insight from, by analogy, the old media to the internet, we haven't had much of a problem doing that when it comes to indecency. There was a case called Reno v. ACLU, and indecency rules under the internet are subject to very high scrutiny. When it comes to rules like the equivalent of a common carrier rule for phone systems where everyone can have access to, I'll just say what it's called, network neutrality. There's a rule called network neutrality that the FCC adopted in 2010, which would require phone and cable companies to not discriminate among different websites and different technologies on the internet. Right? You couldn't have Comcast or Verizon decide that Google's YouTube would load faster than Netflix. Couldn't cut an exclusive deal with Yahoo over Facebook. Right? So that rule is now before the DC Circuit. Verizon challenged it, and Verizon made a First Amendment argument saying we want to be able to edit things on the internet, make special deals with certain companies to determine what speech would get privilege on the internet. And whether or not that's a dumb rule, the argument that's made is Verizon in offering internet access is much like a newspaper editing and choosing what's in a newspaper. And the argument on the other side is we should think of those who provide broadband no different than we would think of common carrier rules for the phone system. And all of this sort of in the weeds argument sort of sidesteps whether, if there's a difference with how I access the internet on the wireline side, if that should be treated like broadcast or not. And the real key question sort of becomes, which dumb laws do we think should be unconstitutional? And the dumb laws that we've sort of agreed should be unconstitutional tend to be indecency, censorship, deciding which speech should not be available to listeners and viewers. And the ones that have tended to be constitutional, or at least tend to pass intermediate scrutiny or get lower scrutiny, tend to be those that encourage a diversity of sources, either through must carry or ensuring that different sources can be carried on cable, that anyone can make phone calls or access the internet. And those that are applied to those technologies we think of as conduits, not as speakers. So to phone and cable companies, for example, and not to those that we consider speakers like, you know, the NewYorkTimes.com. And it tends to be a sort of idea that we will let the government, to some extent, especially Congress, balance the different speech interests of the conduit, folks who want access to the conduit, and the listeners and viewers who want to have access to the internet or TV over cable. And so that's my reading of it. But we're at a place where I think First Amendment law is in some disarray, and the technological changes of the last 10 years will force the issue soon.
Commissioner Pai.
First, I want to thank the Federalist Society and the Practice Group in particular for inviting me and my distinguished co-panelists for participating in this conversation. I also want to thank Judge Kavanaugh for taking time away from the bench to moderate this discussion, and thank all of you for coming. I'm often asked what my job is at the FCC, and in large respect, it is squaring the circle. And by that, I mean that one of the greatest challenges I've confronted during my 18 months at the FCC is that we are charged with administering statutes that were generally designed to address market conditions at a specific moment in time. And especially in an industry as dynamic as the communications sector, that's pretty difficult. Now, oftentimes that suggestion is thought to apply mainly to some of the original provisions of the Communications Act that are now 79 years old. But even a statute of relatively more recent vintage can present some of these problems. And I'll focus in particular on the topic that Miguel introduced, which is the problems that stem from the Cable Act of 1992. Now, if you look at the marketplace when the Cable Act was enacted, over President Bush's veto, I might add, you see a very different marketplace. Cable companies had a 95% market share. Now, we all discuss market power in the antitrust context, and there's a debate whether 50% or 60% would suffice. 95% is pretty strong market power. The vast majority of Americans cannot choose any other competitive multi-channel video programming distributor option. There was no satellite, there was no over-the-top. There were only about 70 cable programming networks. And needless to say, the internet more or less did not exist, and so video over the internet didn't exist either. And so it's no surprise when you look at some of the legislative history of the Cable Act, you see statements that ring hollow to modern ears, I mean, especially for people who are, say, between 18 and 30 and live in the era that we now do. Take, for example, the second finding that Congress adopted when it implemented the Cable Act. If you don't mind my quoting from 20-year-old legislative history, it doesn't make for more entertaining listening, I know. But most cable television subscribers have no opportunity to select between competing cable systems. Without the presence of another multi-channel video programming distributor, a cable system faces no local competition. The result is undue market power for the cable operator as compared to that of consumers and video programmers. And on the floor of Congress, too, you saw a lot of members from both sides of the aisle attacking what they saw as cable's bottleneck over the video marketplace. Senator Durenberger, for example, a Republican from Minnesota, said, and I quote, "Currently, cable operators are in a position to ignore requests for services and complaints about customer service due to the complete lack of alternatives available to the customer. This bill is vital in the effort to address the problems inherent in an unregulated monopolistic situation. Customers have absolutely no choice and no voice in their frustrating dealings with cable." Now, today, suffice it to say, as others have pointed out, the market has changed dramatically, even though the Cable Act remains on the books. For one thing, as Miguel pointed out, the entrance of satellite competitors has eaten away tremendously at cable's market share. I think the two DBS providers in combination have around a 30% share. Similarly, almost all Americans now have a choice of not two, but three MVPDs, and a third of Americans have a choice of four, thanks in part to the entry of some of the telephone companies. Similarly, the market share of incumbent cable operators has dropped below 60%, and if you look at the trend line, it's going ever lower. There are now over 500 cable and satellite programming networks. And over-the-top providers, too, have entered the marketplace in a big way. one of the things I find fascinating is talking to people in the younger generation about how they consume video. And if you talk to them about, you know, cable linear lineups with hundreds of channels that they have to scroll through on a big television, their eyes glaze over, because to them, video is completely indifferent as to the distribution platform and even the device that's being used. I mean, they think of video as being wherever they are. So it's mobile, as Marvin pointed out, on tablets or smartphones. And so as a result, over-the-top providers have stepped into the breach. I had the privilege of meeting last year a woman who has created for herself a huge following online by creating a YouTube channel over which she's generated millions of page views. She's completely bypassed the traditional bottleneck that Senator Durenberger identified 21 years ago in a way that he could never have even conceived. So from my perspective, applying a law that was written in 1992 to apply to the video marketplace as it exists in 2013 obviously presents a number of difficult policy questions. But more importantly, for the purpose of today's panel, it also presents a number of difficult First Amendment questions. Because after all, as has been well established for at least 2 decades, as the Supreme Court has told us, cable operators do engage in the transmission of speech, and they do exercise editorial control. And so the courts traditionally have applied intermediate scrutiny to regulations that would purport to regulate what the cable operators are doing in this regard. And as many of you know, the two questions that the courts have asked and that the agency ideally would ask in advance is, number one, does the regulation advance an important governmental interest aside from the suppression of speech? And number two, if so, does the regulation substantially burden more speech than is necessary to achieve that governmental interest? And the answer to those questions, of course, depends on the particulars of the regulation. But in general, those answers are going to change depending on what the market structure is in any given point in time. And so I would submit to you that given the changes in the marketplace since 1992, one would expect that the courts would yield different results. And that is indeed what we have seen in recent months and years. Just to give you one example, a couple of months ago, the Second Circuit in Time Warner Cable versus FCC rejected a First Amendment challenge to the FCC's program carriage regime. That regime essentially prohibits cable operators from preferring affiliated networks to those that are unaffiliated. But in reaching this decision, the Second Circuit did give the FCC a pretty clear warning, and with the indulgence of all of you, I'll just quote it briefly. At oral argument, the FCC acknowledged the possibility that at some future time, the conclusion that for the program carriage regime survives intermediate scrutiny will no longer obtain in light of increased competition in the video programming industry. And similarly, before that, the DC Circuit in the Comcast v. FCC case rejected the FCC's finding that Comcast had engaged in impermissible discrimination under Section 616 of the Communications Act. And in a brilliant, incisive, and learned concurring opinion, I'm invoking the two tried and true traditions, in pandering to the moderator and pandering to the courts. Judge Kavanaugh made a similar point to the Second Circuit when he wrote that in restricting the editorial discretion of video programming distributors, the FCC cannot continue to implement a regulatory model premised on a 1990s snapshot of the cable market. And that's especially the case, as he said, and as I believe, when we are administering a statute like Section 616 that imports within the communications field the traditional tenets of antitrust law, which is that you have market power. In other words, the entire regulatory framework is premised on a finding of market power. Judge Kavanaugh went on to quote Buckley v. Valeo in pointing out that in today's highly competitive market, it can't be said that Comcast or frankly any other MVPD has real market power in this national market. And so in the particular case, the FCC had no reason to find that Tennis Channel had been impermissibly discriminated against. Now my own view, and I don't want to speak for my colleagues or for the rest of the agency, but my own view is that the FCC should heed these warnings. And I think that when you have a number of different courts that are starting to find that the foundation for this entire framework has shifted, then it becomes incumbent upon the agency to take one of two courses. Number one, either do what we've been doing, which is interpret the statute in the very same way and ignore the way the marketplace has changed, or number two, exercise regulatory humility and, to the extent possible, refrain from engaging in judgments that require courts to grapple with these difficult constitutional issues, which may end up ultimately invalidating not just the agency's own flexibility, but as Marvin pointed out, whatever Congress might want to do in the future. And so just to offer one example, in Tennis Channel, my own view, as I expressed in the dissent that we issued, was that the FCC had no basis factually for finding that Tennis Channel engaged in impermissible discrimination, and also that making that finding would run afoul of the market power structure that Congress had assumed to be the case when it adopted the Cable Act. So with that basic framework, I would punt it to all of you and ask you to think about where you see the line being drawn in the future, what the FCC's role should be in this area, because it's an area that's in flux, and I think the question at this point is not whether we have reached the inflection point, but what we should do, assuming we have. So thanks again to the judge and to my panelists, and look forward to the discussion.
I think I'll roll it back around for comments after hearing from each person, comments that you might have or reactions you might have. And I guess, Mr. Estrada, I'd start with you. And one of the things that comes to mind, you can, whatever reactions you have, but one of the things that comes to mind when thinking about some of the cases you argued and have been involved in litigation, including the indecency cases. And what is, what is the FCC's role these days with, appropriate role with children, with parents who sit on their couch gripping the clicker to change it rapidly when something comes on the screen that they don't want their children to see? Does the FCC have any role there? And if so, what is it?
Well, I think it's a very limited role. I mean, I was thinking about the indecency case when Professor Amore was talking about dumb laws. He is right that this one sort of strikes many people as a dumb law. The point that we should all keep in mind is that dumb and illegal is not a dichotomy. Something can be dumb and unconstitutional. The indecency cases, I think, are a good example of the types of larger principles that we should keep in mind, because at some point we end up thinking about these cases as involving some cokehead starlet who blurts out something that she should not have during an award show, and if one were to have, the view that Justice Stevens have in the Pacifica case, the notion of a pig in a parlor comes to mind. But the fact is that people use expletives wittingly or unwittingly to express deep and large thoughts or to express themselves in a free society. And you cannot entirely curb the ability of adults to express themselves with these words, nor should you want to, just as you would not want in cases like Butler versus Michigan, where the issue was whether you could keep every bookseller from selling things that were unsuitable for children, to say that the town bookstore could not have certain things that are unsuitable for children, and thereby bring the entire adult population down to only the level of what's suitable for children. Having said that, I think parents who are concerned about the proliferation of coarseness in society are right to be concerned about that, and I don't think that government should be unavailable as a help to parental intervention. But there are ways in which the government can, as it has done, intervene to help parents make right choices for their children that do not invade the freedom of everybody else. There are parental controls on televisions that are not mandated. There are ways to lock and screen out some of these things. There are any number of safe harbors, like technologies and time safe harbors. Obviously, you can do many of these things after 10, and yet people don't. I do think that it is okay to be sympathetic to the ability of government to help people who want to raise their children in the manner that they find suitable. It may not be that it is, the role of government to bring the entire adult population to the level of four-year-olds. And I think that has been, the problem. They can do that themselves.
Yeah.
Every 4 years, they have been. But, you know, and so, I mean, I think it is true, as Professor Mori also said, that a lot of this turns on the mode of analysis, and every lawyer is very good at picking what the analogy is, whether this is just a conduit or whether it is something else. Of course, no one would think that a publisher like Regnery or pick your mainstream publisher is just a conduit. And so if you come with the determination that the cable company is just a conduit, you have already made a judgment as to the amount of regulation that you're prepared to allow as to that medium of communication. As it happened in the Turner case, the Supreme Court rejected the conduit theory of cable and said that cable distributors are editors, that they have their own First Amendment rights. They're entitled to select a bundle of what they will offer to the consumer by exercising editorial control. And I don't think, in fact, that there is even any service that is exclusively a conduit. A phone, if you hold it out as a conduit for the communication with your friends, can still be quite different if it's being used for the transmission of programming over the phone lines to compete with Comcast. And if the phone company is selling that service, it is indistinguishable from Comcast as a distributor and selector of content. No one would say that the phone company in that context is a conduit.
Ms. Mago, one thing I was thinking about in listening to you are in such an interesting position with the topic of this panel, I think, your clients, because on the one hand, obviously, pushing First Amendment rights against certain kinds of government regulation, but on the other hand, with respect to Turner issues and placement and your issues vis-a-vis cable companies, sometimes pushing in the opposite direction against assertion of First Amendment rights by cable companies. I guess I'm curious, did Turner make a mistake in treating cable companies as First Amendment editors? And if not, where do we stand today with the changing marketplace, and how should we think about cable? The cable companies are really not the, as we've said and we know, are not the sole player there in that marketplace today.
I think it's true. They may not be the sole player, but they still have a certain role in terms of providing access to an awful lot of the ideas. In a lot of ways, I liked the way that Professor Mori set this up. Is, you know, there are some things that are censorship of ideas, that are other things that are promoting access to information and promoting ideas. And that was one of the other bases for the Turner decision. And in fact, when the court looked at it, it also said that there was not an undue burden on saying, look, you should make sure that there continues to be access to these other sort of unique voices that are in the market. It's they looked at the capacity on the cable systems at the time and said that capacity is such that you're not putting an undue burden on their ability to have editorial control over the remainder of the channels. It was basically a third. If anything that has happened since then, that capacity has increased. The amount of the burden that is done by that's put on by the particularly the Muscari rule, which is the key issue, was the key issue at Turner, has decreased as well. And so I think that's a factor that I think that we ought to think about as we go in. You're absolutely right that part of my job on an interesting basis is trying to figure out, okay, which side am I looking at here? And I think that the one that looks at promoting ideas on a content-neutral basis in any way like that, that's one that broadcasters are generally in favor of, trying to make sure that there is there's access to that information. But when we draw the line, it's when there tends to be something that gets more into the line of censorship and more into the line of trying to say, no, we want you to promote this particular idea. Because we think that this particular speech is more important to get out. And whether that tends to be something that falls into the realm of public interest obligations, people are always saying there's a public interest obligation to do one thing or another, that's when we start to say there needs to be a really careful scrutiny of what it is that the government is trying to impose.
I'd ask you one follow-up, which is from your perspective, where do we stand First Amendment law policy with
the different regulatory regimes that broadcasters are on, the traditional broadcasters vis-a-vis the other, the HBOs and the Showtimes and what have you, and how sustainable is that, and what's your view on how that's ultimately going to play out?
It's very hard to say how it's going to play out. I do know that I was on a panel this morning, and somebody mentioned that the FCC continues to get complaint after complaint about various indecency, and they said that one of the big fixes for that is to stop miking NFL players. I think that would be one way. But I do that as an aside. But your real question was, how do you figure out where these lines ought to be, and understanding, how do you really make the regulations work? And I think that you have to do it with a certain amount of humility. You've got to allow a lot of editorial discretion on the part of any of the operators that are out there. And I think I just forgot the second half of your question, to be honest. But
I'm going to ask Professor Amori a question about Turner as well, because it seems when we talk about the FCC, and in the First Amendment context, all roads still lead to Turner, in the sense of, if you read a decision on this, really any of the issues, Turner sets forth the principles that we're still thinking about. And Turner, as we know, has some very pro-free speech language, but also has some language that's very pro-regulatory, pro-diversity of sources and information, as Ms. Mago says. And it was based on a conception of the marketplace at the time. So I guess, what is the continuing relevance of Turner, and how do we know, or when that picture of the marketplace on which they were premising some of the discussion there has changed sufficiently that the analysis is no longer working for us?
So Turner, and I think the way I interpret that question is, Turner took the landscape at the time to be fairly uncompetitive, and now the marketplace is more competitive. And
I would just add, it also, though, as Ms. Mago points out, has language in there that talks about other rationales, yep, for regulation, including getting consumers diversity of information.
Yep. So, so first we have to ask whether or not the market is sufficiently uncompetitive now under the First Amendment, right? So today, perhaps, there's, I guess, 60% market share locally for cable companies when it comes to video, about, I think, 80% when it comes to broadband, because satellite companies aren't a big player in that market. And so the question is, is that high enough for an antitrust case under some circumstances? And I'm not sure that's the right question. I think the First Amendment, by its language and by its precedent, is less concerned with pure competition analysis. The language in Turner had to do with bottleneck power. That was the language used. And it's not quite clear if that means the terminating access monopoly or something short of what would have been under antitrust laws as an uncompetitive market. And when you look at that case, it's a complicated enough case. You have Turner 1, where the must carry rules go before the court, there's a 5-4 decision, they send it back to Congress for more fact gathering, it comes back up, there's a new judge around, Justice Breyer. What's Justice Breyer gonna do? He concurs on two of the three rationales. So he concurs on the rationale that there's an important interest to forcing cable companies to carry broadcasters. The important interest, one, is to ensure that people who don't have cable can still watch over-the-air TV, so these channels don't die, right? The other one had to do with ensuring a diversity of sources. And the third one, the one that Justice Breyer did not accept, was competition. Right? He had taught antitrust, thought it like an antitrust professor, and he said, I don't see a, quote, antitrust problem here. And so the majority of the five of them agreed on two of the three rationales, not the competition rationale. And so you can interpret that different ways, but I do think that even if you can't bring an antitrust case properly, still under the First Amendment, Congress would have latitude to try to encourage more sources for people who can't afford cable or for people who do have cable but want more sources.
You had mentioned earlier about dumb laws and unconstitutional laws. One of the things the Supreme Court has said in certain cases, and one of the things we don't focus on much, but they said certainly in a case involving the Line Item Veto Act, and cases involving the legislative veto, that even laws that might make a lot of sense as a policy matter may be unconstitutional as well, that those laws to control spending and to limit regulatory overreach were struck down by the Supreme Court. So it's interesting, the dumb law, smart law versus unconstitutional does not map on any dimension necessarily in some of the Supreme Court case law. I would ask before I go to the commissioner for follow-up, if people have questions, and I hope you do, or comments, please start lining up now. And commissioner, I would ask you something that I've thought about, which is the FCC, or let me back up, when courts approach First Amendment issues and people advocate deference to the court or restraint to the court, one of the things that's usually embedded in that is that Congress has consider the law independently, and the executive has made an independent judgment to enforce the law and believes it constitutional as well. Obviously, when the FCC issues a regulation under some general authority where Congress hasn't considered the specific law, and obviously an independent agency, so the president, the attorney general, haven't necessarily passed on the constitutionality of the law. Curious how you think that should affect, if at all, First Amendment analysis, and it's really related to a question I think Justice Breyer identified in FCC versus Fox on the ad law side, which is, does the status of the FCC as an independent agency affect the ordinary administrative law deference that the agency gets? So from your experience, and you have a lot of it in the FCC now in a different position, what's your take on how the FCC operates as compared to other agencies that are executive agencies, and how does that affect deference doctrines, do you think?
That's a great question. I mean, quite often, I can tell you, not just in the context of administering Title VI, we encounter situations where the statute requires us to do something which pretty clearly everyone agrees, parties to the proceeding and the various commissioners, doesn't make any sense. It might have made sense in 1992 or earlier, but it just doesn't make any sense anymore. Nonetheless, we have to engage our Office of General Counsel and our own lawyers and within the commissioner's offices to engage in some pretty sophisticated gymnastics to make sure that whatever regulations we are promulgating try to accommodate these changed circumstances yet still remain true to these obsolete statutory requirements. And so I guess the question when for you and for the other courts becomes more difficult because it's hard for the FCC or anyone else to argue to the courts that their judgments deserve deference because they are the expert agency, they have studied this issue carefully, and they've threaded the needle in a way that satisfies the statutory requirements and reflects a changed marketplace, given the fact that a lot of these statutes are so out of date that the regulations just on their face can often be absurd. So I think the counterpart to Fox 2, I think, is coming on the substantive side. And I don't envy your task, frankly, because you may indeed have to engage in more searching scrutiny without a well-established framework or precedent to allow you to do that. If I could just add one, until somebody, a questioner comes up, I just want to address one thing that Marvin brought up and that Jane brought up. And that is, and if you don't ask a question, I'm just going to filibuster. It's up to you.
Someone line up.
So Marvin posited the distinction between a dumb law involving, say, censorship and a not-so-dumb law involving something to the effect of promoting independent voices or more diverse voices. And I don't necessarily disagree with those two categorizations, but what I would say is that it's much more of a muddied continuum as opposed to two different buckets. And let me just give you one example. Another requirement under Title VI of the Communications Act requires cable operators to set aside up to 15% of their capacity to make it available and to sell it at rates that they don't choose for independent the transmission of independent programming. Now, if you apply this to virtually any other industry and you asked any regulated utility or non-regulated company, for that matter, Yeah, what would you think if the government came in and said, you shall sell 15% of your capacity at below cost rates to people who you aren't affiliated with? I mean, there would be an immediate outcry. And I would submit that from a First Amendment perspective, it's not entirely clear to me that the least access regime, as it's called, is clearly on the side of promoting independent voices. And the reason is that there's a lot of evidence that people have adduced in the record of the FCC and just generally that in some cases, affiliation with an MVPD like a cable company can actually promote more independent voices. And the reason is that cable companies have an interest in making sure that the networks they transmit over their, the programming they transmit over the network succeeds. And so they might take an interest in making sure that that network has sufficient funding, for example, to develop new programming, has enough of the overhead covered so that they can focus on making cutting-edge programming that's going to appeal to subscribers. And so if you take away some of that capacity and set it aside for non-affiliated programmers, there's a very real risk that you might inadvertently harm consumers in the end because they won't have access to some of that programming. So all of which is to say that censorship on one hand and independent voices on the other is not exactly a clear distinction in a lot of cases.
Professor, Ms. Mago, that response really also goes to something you said, that because you had identified, I think, those two different buckets. Mm-hmm. What do you think about that? It's more of a continuum.
I tend to agree with it. I think there really is a continuum. You have to look at everything on its individual facts. I think that's one of the key functions of the FCC. But I do think that we've been talking about Turner and we've been talking about the Cable Act and kind of mushing everything together and suggesting, well, times have changed, therefore it's no good. And I think what I started to say to begin with is that same kind of a continuum approach, that I think we have to look at what are all of the purposes that were behind Turner to begin with, what are the various interests that it is in fact promoting, and decide whether some of those continue to be valid, whether we should make some changes, there should be things that go in there. Interestingly, as I was thinking about the Cable Act while everybody was talking, I was thinking that there are different forms of regulation in there. There's some of them that the Act itself had some things where there were economic regulation in the sense of that there was rate regulation. And over time, that has actually gone away to a large extent as competition has come in. There are other provisions of it that I think were more towards that idea of trying to make sure that there continued to be independent voices in a market, even if you had some place where there was a 60% MVPD concentration, or in some markets there's actually a 90% MVPD concentration of one particular operator. And those are intended to keep those voices. And I think that as we look at policy and as we look at how this affects the First Amendment, you have to keep in mind that there are those factors that need to be taken into account.
Commissioner, one thing that your comments and Ms. Mago's just now prompted for me is, if you were landing from Mars and you heard everyone saying the law's outdated, it's 20 years old, you would say, well, why don't you pass a new law? So I'm just curious with the FCC and really its relationship with Congress, both in suggesting new legislation, and we all realize how challenging that is, but also in the other direction, in your new capacity as commissioner, Congress's influence on the FCC. I think we'd all be interested in just hearing your assessment of the FCC and congressional relationship, because that affects a lot of these issues as well.
Sure, that's a terrific question. Over the last 18 months, I've had numerous opportunities to engage with Congress, both in a formal setting, an oversight hearing, for example, or on a more informal basis, just meeting with members. And I can tell you that all of them seem to appreciate the marketplace has changed tremendously, but none of them seem to agree on a single solution. And so part of the problem for them is coming up with some type of reform that's going to pass muster with both sides of the aisle and both houses of Congress. There are a number of different ways that Congress could go about reforming the statute, of course. The most prominent among them is the reauthorization of what's called STELA, the Satellite Television Extension Localism Act, which is due to expire at the end of next year. And a number of different members have suggested using that as a vehicle for making more substantial changes to the video laws that apply to this space. And, I've said to them, and I'll say here, that I stand willing and able to work with them if they require FCC advice on any particular proposed reform. But I certainly wouldn't purport to want to suggest to them what I think the law must be. I certainly take the one-directional relationship that Congress has with its subordinate agency seriously. But I think there is there are a lot of ideas bubbling up in Congress, and you may see action in the near future.
Mr. Estrada, on that on the deference point we were talking about, and you obviously deeply involved in FCC versus Fox and the question of deference to the FCC, given that it's not directly or really even indirectly supervised by the president, what's your thought on all that?
Well, the most sort of astonishing aspect of the decision was not even that, but the fact that the deference was actually on a policy implementing a criminal statute, which is not administered by the FCC or any other agency. It is administered by the courts. But I think ultimately, if you have a delegation of actual authority to an independent agency, I think that that's in the ballpark of what you usually think of as Chevron territory, and you sort of assume in effect that there is a delegation of authority to the agency to fill in gaps, et cetera. And so, the notion that the agency will get deference on questions of what is best to do to fix the situation is not all that alien to me. The notion that they have an independent duty to consider the constitutional question and therefore get deference on already having taken a first crack at the difficult question of whether this is in fact okay under the Constitution is more outlandish, because many agencies take the view that they don't even have the power to consider the question of constitutionality. So positing deference for an entire area that they don't believe themselves empowered to really actually reach seems to me counterintuitive. On the larger point of the First Amendment here, I don't want to lose track of the fact that Turner, for all of its vices, is very unclear as to what exactly is the rationale for why this is content neutral. I mean, there was, to some extent, the notion that even though this may not be an antitrust claim, there is a market regulation rationale, and all that the court cares for intermediate scrutiny is that it not be speech-based. It could be something else that is non-speech-based, and in this case, it's market regulation, whether or not, the market is dysfunctional in an antitrust way. Now, the second aspect of it is, it's very difficult to me to know to what extent the reliance or the advertence to diversity is an independent basis for Turner, because it seems to be facially at odds with the proposition that this is content neutral. If you're trying to say that this is content neutral because it's actually directed at market regulation, and it is also not involving content, because it really, at the end of the day, you're talking about the transmission of electrons. You're just shifting broadcast TV from this bucket to this bucket, and you're not looking at what's in it. To get from that an independent interest in diversity, which connotes looking for different types of views or looking at what the views are, seems to be very problematic. Now, Ms. Mago said, oh, you can go very far in the direction of actually picking one of them. But again, it is true that you can go really far and then have the worst possible case to be viewpoint discrimination. But just because something isn't viewpoint discrimination, it doesn't mean that it isn't content-based.
Professor Amore, what are your thoughts here on the, including on the diversity point and also on the content-based versus content-neutral, which in so much of First Amendment law really, once you figure that out, that answers the question. And what's your sense of where Turner left us on content-based versus content-neutral in this kind of area?
Sure. I mean, so in Turner, it was considered a very hard question. The five judges in the majority believed the rule requiring must-carrier broadcast stations was content-neutral. The four in the dissent thought it was content-based, and that essentially decided the decision. And I agree with Miguel that the court is very confused about what they mean by content-based regulation in that decision. If you read it very carefully, it seems to be that they define, in that case only, content-based to mean viewpoint-based. And so essentially the majority is saying this isn't viewpoint-based. And an interesting thing is the court also doesn't seem to think, and the language they use tends to be promoting diverse and antagonistic sources. That promoting diverse sources isn't content-based, even though the reason why they promote diverse sources is an assumption that there would be diversity of views. Right? And so it feels as though the court is fine with Congress going one step closer to sources versus actually trying to get views that are diverse. And so I think the way I interpret it, sort of abstracting away from Turner and a whole bunch of other cases that have to do with must carry, common carrier, even the least access rule, which was upheld under the First Amendment, is that as a general rule, the courts tend to think that if it's not viewpoint-based in terms of the content that's being promoted, and not content-based in terms of the content that's being burdened, then generally a rule like that is upheld.
So tennis and golf, is that just content or is that viewpoint?
Tennis.
I think
and
we're
golf.
Talking angels and pins here.
So you're. What are you? Yeah, good question. I haven't even thought about that. I don't think it's viewpoint.
Commissioner, when the commission is making decisions, how do you all sit around and decide is this content based? Is it content neutral? What kind of factors is the commission looking at in making that very hard call?
Amazingly enough, we actually asked ourselves some of the same questions that Miguel adverted to. We wondered why was Golf Channel the appropriate foil for the Tennis Channel? And when you start to think about it, I mean, you start drawing on all these sort of personal experiences that really shouldn't have any part of the administrative process. You know, I think, oh yeah, my dad used to like tennis. He also likes golf. He watches both. So maybe they are comparable. But, you know, I like tennis, but I hate golf. So is it really, I mean, it's sort of, there's no real reasoned basis. And I'm glad, frankly, that the courts never knew, got insight into some of our thinking about why we drew these lines, because I can assure you the deference would not be in question at that point. but I do think it requires us to draw some really difficult lines. And I think in Tennis Channel in particular, I mean, one of the things that was easy to do, at least for our office, was to figure out what were the patterns of carriage among the different MVPDs. And so, you know, one of the things I asked my staff to do was find out how often the other carriers carried the Tennis Channel compared to Comcast. And what we found was that, you know, Comcast was actually part of the norm. They might not carry a Tennis Channel as broadly on the more prominent tiers, but the basic tier, but you know, they weren't doing anything unusual. And so then, once we realized that, then it just became a question of, well, what is the majority doing when it is making a finding of discrimination? And at that point, it just seemed like it was either this sort of odd line drawing about, or odd linkage of tennis and golf, or just a base finding of market power. And so sprinkled through the decision, as you probably saw, there are a lot of references, and I cited them in my dissent. Just Comcast is big. You know, it has 24 million subscribers across the country. They have a lot of market power in particular markets. They're just big. Now, that isn't necessarily untrue. I mean, 24 million is a pretty big number, but when you think about the fact that Netflix actually has more subscribers than Comcast, when you think about the fact that Netflix now has more subscribers than every other cable provider in the country combined other than Comcast, well, what does big really mean? I mean, the question really is, you know, what is the appropriate denominator? And to me, we've got to think about the denominator much more broadly than we did back in 1992. So I hope that's a roundabout way of answering your question.
So again, if people have questions, please ask them. I am gonna offer one idea that I would like reaction to from the panelists, which is, given that this is the Federalist Society, we like to talk about separation of powers, and it's not just the First Amendment that protects liberty, it's the separation of powers that protects liberty. And that, what we mean by that usually is it's very hard to pass a law. It takes two houses of Congress, it takes the president to concur, and therefore to pass a law, to begin with, from the state of non-regulation takes a lot of effort. That's how the separation of powers protects liberty, and then the courts are yet another check on that. But in an odd way, the separation of powers over time makes it hard to protect liberty in the sense that it's very hard to undo a law that may have been passed at a particular time that infringes liberty. So just as it's hard to pass a law, it's hard to undo a law. One of the ways Congress has gotten around this in certain areas is sunset laws. And so this is the reaction or the idea I want to throw out there is your reaction to the idea of more sunset laws in Congress for things like the Cable Act. You think about the Independent Counsel Act, something that a lot of people thought was a big intrusion on liberty. Well, it had a sunset provision. It had to come up and be voted on every 5 years. The Patriot Act, which obviously triggered lots of discussion about infringement on individual liberties, also had a sunset because members of Congress thought maybe we should revisit this. And of course, when you revisit it, that changes the baseline of how hard it is to pass. You think in this area, is that's something that Congress should look at to the extent it regulates more in the future or legislates more in the future, sunsetting provisions because of the changing nature of the marketplace? What's your general reaction to those?
I guess could I jump in on that? I certainly think it would be a great idea. I mean, I think it helps, frankly, when Congress and or the agency regularly are required to revisit some of these requirements to determine whether they continue to be necessary in the public interest. And I've certainly advocated, even if Congress doesn't require or doesn't implement a sunset clause, for the agency to self-impose one. So if it adopts a novel regulation promulgating a certain rule, that rule might be out of date, especially in this area, pretty quickly. And so I've urged my colleagues to do that more frequently. One other option that Congress has exercised once in the relatively recent past, which I think would address your problem, is forbearance. So when it comes to telecommunications regulation, as some of you might know, Congress has given us the power under Section 10 of the Communications Act to forbear from the enforcement of regulation if it makes a determination that that regulation is no longer necessary in the interest of competition, consumer protection, and the like. That has been an extremely useful tool for the FCC to refrain from the enforcement of a statutory requirement that might have made sense decades ago but doesn't anymore. One of the things I've proposed, and I think it's starting to get a little bit of traction on Capitol Hill, and hopefully within the FCC itself, is the idea of having cable forbearance, allowing the FCC to do within the context of Title VI what we are currently allowed to do within the context of Title II. And this would be a terrific way, I think, I would humbly posit to Congress, of solving some of the problem that the judge identified, which is that it's very difficult for Congress to pass a law amending the operative provisions of the Communications Act. If Congress simply gave us authority in one section of the Communications Act to forbear from the enforcement of certain Title VI regulations in a similar way that it does with Title II, it wouldn't have to prescribe in any necessary detail what the regulatory framework of the video marketplace would have to be going forward. It could essentially delegate that to the agency, subject, of course, to the review by the courts. But it would give the agency a lot more flexibility, and I can tell you that in a lot of different areas, this would be very helpful. This certainly would not open up the floodgates to deregulation. I would submit that the FCC would actually act judiciously under leadership of both political parties, because I think that there's a common interest among my colleagues and I that we don't want to be hampered by these outdated statutory regulations. So cable forbearance would be something, in addition to sunset clauses, that would help us.
There's another option, too, which is that, and in fact, it's in the Cable Act itself, that Congress had certain identifiable time frames that caused something else to happen. And for example, with regard to cable rate regulation, they said if there was a competitive market, that then cable rate regulation would go away. And in fact, the agency has implemented that over time. And that's another possibility of things that can happen here. I think you also have to, I would also observe that Stella, that you mentioned earlier, is a law that has a sunset. In fact, it's been tried to be sunset at least four times.
Right.
And has caused, and each time it comes back, it seems to try to turn to morph into something else, which is, to me, a little bit scary. But that's another possibility.
Well, Judge, I mean, the only thing with sunsets is that they're only as good as the capacity of the agency to actually let go, because we have some in the Communications Act, and in fact some have been to the D.C. Circuit. I think there's an opinion by Judge Santel in one of the Cablevision cases where the agency just keeps extending the sunset, making findings that it is still really necessary, and with each sort of finding for an extra 5 years, the justifications get more and more transparently thin. And the last time, I think, you know, the D.C. Circuit, two to one, sort of upheld them with a serious finger wagging. You know, last time. But if you posit a sunset where you give the ability to the agency to keep extending it based on shifting justifications, you are basically shifting the problem of the democratic protection of liberty to an agency that may well be captured by people who have no interest in any of these ideals.
There are two
ways you could do a sunset. One is that the law itself sunsets, the statute sunsets, and the other way, more common, as Mr. Estrada points out, at least in this field, is that it gives the agency essentially authority to forbear, as the commissioner also pointed out, and the agency essentially the delegated authority to sunset enforcement of the law in some respects.
I was only going to observe that in terms of the broadcast ownership rules, we've been supposedly looking at those to try to get rid of them as well. I just throw that out there because my members would want me to.
If I can just defend the absence of sunsets in principle at some points. You know, when I speak to folks in Silicon Valley occasionally, they talk about the importance of certainty, right? Everyone, all investors and business types talk about the importance of certainty when they have what they want. And if you have a rule that sunsets every 3 years or every 4 years, it makes it hard for people to plan and invest. And so there's some areas where you wouldn't want to have a sunset. And when Ajit mentioned Title II and Title VI, which is code for the title that regulates phone companies and the title that regulates cable companies. There is no title that regulates like internet stuff.
I'm so glad to hear you say that. there's a few out there that title two might.
Oh yeah.
There are those that are trying that.
Yeah. Well, if the FCC reclassifies. But the point is that there's a reason why that the Congress hasn't ended up making a law there, passing a law, and we have something like reverse forbearance, which was a provision 706 of the Telecom Act, which says if the FCC makes a determination at some point that the rollout of broadband isn't proceeding as it should, then the FCC gets this authority. And so that's actually probably the main question at the moment in the Verizon v. FCC case regarding net neutrality. Has this sort of reverse forbearance kicked in as the FCC claims it has, and now the FCC might have authority that's somewhat undefined under this new provision, the sort of opposite forbearance?
Ryan, we have a question.
I do. I'm actually going to kill two birds with one stone. I was going to assume the podium later to make an announcement, but I'll have a question and do the announcement as well. First of all, I'm Brian Tremont. I'm the chair of the practice group, the telecommunications practice group. I want to encourage everyone in the room to join the practice group. It's a great organization. We're very active, a number of great programs, podcasts, opportunities to write, and leadership opportunities. So please talk to David Ray, talk to the practice group heads. Matthew Berry is on the executive committee with me of the practice group. It'd be great to have more people involved. So I wanted to get that plug in. The second thing I wanted to do, I want to follow up with what Jane just mentioned, which is the media ownership proceeding. We didn't talk very much about that today. The cross-media limits on newspaper broadcasts, limits on the amount of broadcast stations that an individual entity can own. I was hoping you guys would comment a little bit on that set of rules and its impact on the First Amendment.
Well, there are times when it puts great limitations. the newspaper cross-ownership rule is actually one that's sort of interesting because that was the rule that was at issue in the Red Lion case way back.
In a later case, the National Citizens Committee, it's a 1978 case, NCCB.
NCCB, yeah. I'm sorry. Which one was Red Lion?
Red Lion had to do with the Fairness Doctrine.
Oh, yeah, that
we
one.
All The ether is a limited government can give it to you on condition that you say only nice things.
NCCB is far less criticized, far less often criticized, the media ownership. Okay, but go on.
No. The only comment that I was going to make was that it does, in fact, assume that you have to have those kinds of restrictions in any given market. That again, it goes a little bit back to the voices, but I think it's one of those that has outlived its usefulness and is on Ajit's continuum.
So, I mean, I began my career in D.C. Working on the media ownership proceedings, advocating, that they should be kept, and in fact that, we should break up big media companies. I was the head lawyer for an advocacy group, and I think It was like stopbigmedia.com was our website.
What did it stand for? I
don't yeah. But as a constitutional matter, I mean, first, as a matter of precedent, you know, the NCCB case and a string of cases on the broadcast side just find that essentially you can promote diversity of sources by having these media ownership limits. The argument on the other side is, you know, essentially that a media company wants to be able to speak to more and more people through different media, and you'd never have a rule saying you can't buy too many pamphlets in a city. That's sort of the argument. So as a matter of precedent, I think, you know, my side is in a good place on the broadcast ownership. But also when you look at other media, you know, there have been rules limiting, you know, whether or not phone companies could buy broadcast stations or phone companies could buy cable stations. There have been rules like that. And it's generally not been thought to be a huge, you know, threat to free expression the same way that indecency or, you know, real content-based censorship would be. But every 4 years, we're supposed to look at those rules, and I think we're like 4 years behind, aren't we?
Yeah, we're currently in the 2010 iteration, and 2014, of course, is just a couple of months away. So I would just say that, you know, I think Marvin has expounded very well the various arguments on both sides of the First Amendment question. To me, just as a policy matter, the limitations are anachronistic enough that they should fall simply as a policy matter, but there are certainly constitutional concerns as well.
With only a few minutes left, I thought, Commissioner, I would turn to you to close us out and just ask you what you see at a broad level, the FCC's agenda going forward. You've been a commissioner now for over a year. What your goals are within the FCC as you look ahead to the rapidly changing marketplace and the FCC's role within it?
Well, sure. Thanks for the opportunity, and thanks once again for coming, all of you. My own general agenda at the FCC has been pretty simple: to make sure that our regulatory framework reflects current marketplace realities. And as I said, that's increasingly difficult when we stand at the intersection of old statutes and new marketplace dynamics. But nonetheless, we have to do the best we can with the statute that we have. And so when it comes to the video marketplace, I will continue speaking out on ways that I think the FCC can modernize its approach to video. On the advocacy side, I'll continue advocating for, you know, cable forbearance and some of the other ideas that I think Congress and others could adopt to help us be more flexible. And when it comes to our own regulation, I will certainly keep advocating for a more judicious approach to Title VI, given the fact that the marketplace has changed so much and that our own statutory power accordingly has changed, as I would see it. So with respect to program carriage disputes, leased access disputes, and those kinds of things, I will certainly try to exercise as much regulatory humility as I can, recognizing that independent programmers, consumers, and others deserve statutory protection, but at the same time that we can't run afoul of some of the constitutional restrictions that, while they might not have been in place in 1992, now are increasingly coming to the fore.
Well, thank you, and thanks to all the panelists for a great panel on these challenging issues, and enjoy. Thank you.